So we left off last time and we just had started Lewis acid base reactions. So that's where we're going to start this time. So Lewis acid base, we've been talking this whole chapter about Bronsted acid bases, and in Bronsted acid base reactions, you transfer a proton. In Lewis acid base reactions, you can transfer a proton, but it's not required that you transfer a proton, so it's a much more general definition. So a Lewis acid is an electron pair acceptor, and a Lewis base is an electron pair donor. So there can be other acids that don't have a proton to donate, and those would be Lewis acids, not Bronsted acids. So all Bronsted acids, Lowry acids, and bases are also Lewis acids and bases, but the converse is not true. So not all Lewis acids are Bronsted acids. Open shell compounds are the best example of Lewis acids that are not Bronsted acids. So I'm going to give you a couple examples on the next page. In the simplest Lewis acid base reaction, one bond is formed and no bonds are broken. This is probably the type that you would have seen in G-Chem. So we have an open shell compound, boron trifluoride, that does not have an octet, likes to accept a pair of electrons from an atom that has a lone pair. So this would be our simplest. So the boron trifluoride accepts an electron pair. So by the Lewis acid base definition, a Lewis acid is an electron pair acceptor, so that means that that's a Lewis acid. Nitrogen donates a pair of electrons, so by the Lewis acid base definition, that would be a Lewis base. So nitrogen donates a pair of electrons. Therefore, it's a Lewis base. And let's draw the product from that reaction. You can call this a Lewis acid base addict. Boron's happy because now it has an octet. Nitrogen's happy it has an octet. We do have a positive charge on nitrogen and a negative charge on boron. All right, another really common Lewis acid that we're going to be working with this year is aluminum trichloride. That also likes to accept a pair of non-bonding electrons from another molecule. So also open shell. So aluminum trichloride open shell. Let's go back up and label the boron trifluoride also as open shell. And so we can draw a similar Lewis acid base addict, but we are making a new covalent bond. Aluminum gets a negative charge and the oxygen gets a positive charge. And the most common example that we will see in organic chemistry over and over and over again, our open shell compound that we commonly see is carbocation. So carbon with only 6 electrons, also just like aluminum trichloride, just like boron trifluoride, likes to accept a pair of electrons. And we're going to be using this reaction at the end of this quarter in chapter 7. So really, really common to see that in organic chemistry. A Lewis acid is also called an electrophile. So we have had textbooks before that didn't really use the term electrophile and nucleophile. They just use Lewis acid, Lewis base. It's more common to use the word electrophile and nucleophile. So a Lewis acid is an electrophile. Which it means electron loving. So remember, phile for loving, electron loving. And electrophiles are electron deficient. A Lewis base, on the other hand, reacts with an electrophile other than a proton. The Lewis base is called a nucleophile. So nucleophiles are electron rich. So nucleophile meaning nucleus loving. And so you can pretty much, all of the reactivity that we're going to see this year is pretty much boils down to electron-rich species reacting with electron-deficient species. So electron-rich species react with electron-poor. So nucleophiles react with electrophiles. Electrophiles don't react with electrophiles. They're both electron poor. They have nothing to offer each other, right? Nucleophiles don't react with nucleophiles because they both are electron rich. They have nothing to offer each other. So the nucleophiles, it's like the rich giving to the poor. The poor don't give to the poor because they don't have anything to give. The nucleophiles, the rich, give to the poor, right? That's kind of what it boils down to. In some Lewis acid-base reactions, one bond is formed and one bond's broken. Draw products of this type reaction. To draw products of this reaction, keep the following steps in mind. Always identify the Lewis acid or electrophile and Lewis base, nucleophile. Draw a curved arrow from the electron pair of the Lewis base to the electron deficient atom of the acid. Count electron pairs and break a bond when needed to keep the correct number of valence electrons. And that's really what we've been doing when we've been doing our resonance structures. It's the same idea. So all of these reactions here, we just have one arrow. Here's an example here where we have more than one arrow. And this is what you're going to see when we don't have things that have open shells. When we have atoms that don't have open shells, but they're electron deficient or electron rich because of partial positive, partial negative charge. So a pi bond is electron rich. We're going to learn about that in the next chapter. So pi bond is electron rich. And we know that hydrochloric acid is polarized, so we have a partial positive charge on hydrogen and a partial negative charge on chlorine. So we do have electron deficient hydrogen. All right, so this is what the arrow pushing would look like. The arrow is going to come, so this is the red arrow is going to come from the pi bond. It's going to attack the hydrogen. And we're going to break the hydrogen-chlorine bond. When we do that, we get a proton is actually transferred here. So this is, we could classify this as a Bronsted acid-base reaction because the proton's being transferred. And we get a carbocation. We also have Cl minus, which is the conjugate base of hydrochloric acid. So this can be classified in both ways. The second reaction that happens here is that we have an open shell carbon, we have a carbocation, we have chloride, which is electron rich, and that can attack. So this looks more like your classic Lewis acid base reaction. We would not be able to classify this as a proton transfer because it's not. Now, this is not a reaction that you need to memorize. We are going to be studying this reaction in detail in chapter 10, but that's not until 51B. So right now, we're just trying to show you some examples of these different types of reactions. All right, so pi bond electron rich, we would call that a nucleophile. Or because this is a Bronsted acid base reaction, we could call this a Bronsted base, right? That's probably the first time you've seen a pi bond act as a base, but it can. And when we'll see this is when we react things that have a pi bond with a really, really strong acid. You know that hydrochloric acid is a really strong acid. So hydrochloric acid, electron deficient. Electron deficient. So we could call it an electrophile. We could also call it a Lewis acid, but we don't really normally do that. Electron deficient, electrophile, or Bronsted acid. Over here, we have a Lewis acid, not a Bronsted acid. We have a Lewis acid, or electrophile. And our electron-rich component is the chloride ion, so we would call this a Lewis base, because it's electron-rich, therefore it's a nucleophile. So you're probably going a little crazy with all this terminology. And here's the way that I normally handle the terminology. These definitions work for multiple types of reactions. So here's the terminology I will use. When it's this type of reaction, classic Lewis acid-base reaction where we're attacking a compound that has an open shell, I will call that a Lewis acid-base reaction. Okay? If it's a proton transfer reaction, so proton transfer, this first reaction here, I would call that an acid-base reaction or a Bronsted acid-base reaction. Okay, this one over here, classic Lewis acid-base reaction because we have a Lewis base attacking something that doesn't have lone pairs. So, but all these terms work and different sources are going to use these terms. So what I did on Wednesday was I added some problems I changed around the problems for the acid base chapter, and they were using electrophile and nucleophile for all of the questions. So I had to go back in and change it to acid and base. So these terms, depending on what book you use, they'll use them. So I do want you to be familiar with them. Questions? Anybody? Yes. You don't need to draw the top two hydrogens, okay? That being said, I do want to say a few things about the practice, I think it was practice number one. I want to say a few things about that. Now, the way we graded this, so this is the problem, you don't have to take it out, I just want to say a few things about it. The way we graded this was if you got you got 1 point for completing it, you got another additional point if you got 3/4 of it right or more. Okay, I just want you to know that on the midterm we don't grade that way. This was a 12-point problem on last year's midterm. So you will get partial credit. So many of you who got 0 wouldn't really get 0 if this was on a test. And many of you who got 1 would not get full credit if it was on the test. So if you were missing a few things, we gave you full credit. But I want to say a couple things about some very common mistakes. By the way, if you got 2 points on this assignment, that means you'll have a 1 on this side and you get a 1 for the other side just for completing it. You are in about the top 10, only about 10 to 15% of the class got the full 2 points. Some very common mistakes that I saw and that made me realize it's a dangerous practice to use skeletal structures when you're doing resonance structures at this point in the game. Once you get better at it, that's going to be okay. But if you exceeded the octet rule on any carbon or atom, you got 0 for that. And so what I saw a lot of people doing were things like this. So we'll start here, going like that. Okay? So going like this and putting a double bond there. Now, of course, if you do that, then nitrogen has no octet. And this carbon, remember, that carbon has three hydrogens. So you've exceeded the octet on this carbon, right? Exceed octet. Very common mistake. Another thing I saw, and then this would stay like this, another thing I saw was students taking this and going here. And so you got zero if you did that because you're exceeding the octet on this carbon. Because this carbon has three hydrogens, remember? So let's just do this. When I give you a resonance structure problem on the test, I will draw in all the atoms. I will not do it skeletal, and I don't recommend that you do it skeletal. Because if you did have these atoms drawn, most people would have caught that, oh my gosh, carbon has five bonds. Okay? So just some things to keep in mind. Hopefully you guys will do better on the midterm than you did on that first practice. But that was just, what, at the end of the first week. So not a huge deal. Okay. Let's take a break and do a iClicker. I hope it works. If it doesn't, I have a transparency. Here's our little guy up at the right. So here's your question. Can everybody read that? Is that not big enough? This is a question off of the midterm. So take out your iClickers. Rank in order of decreasing acidity. Hint, use pKa's rounded to the nearest 5, and this is easy. So we talked about pKa's rounded to the nearest 5 that you will need to know for midterm 1. There's 6 of them. There's also a handout. Before we do this, I'll pull that up. I'll pull that up while you're doing this. There's a handout that's called Approximate pKa's Expanded. You need to look at that handout and know that handout. So I've added 2 more, so there's 8 pKa's you need to know. And those pKa's you will need to know all year long. It's going to make your life much easier. This is a very easy problem if you know the pKa's rounded to the nearest 5. So let's just give this a minute or two here. You'll see how hard of a problem this is, and then you'll see how easy it is. Very quick, easy problem if you know your pKa's rounded to the nearest 5. There's one extra compound on there that's on the expanded chart that is not on the chart that you have in your book. The chart that you have in your book is on page 39, and there's one compound, and that's F, that is on the expanded chart. All right, we'll stop at 2 minutes, so we have about, all right, 10 seconds, so click in with something. All right, so most people said A. That's pretty good. That is the correct answer. Let's go over this, okay? I think A is the correct answer. All right, so I am a person who wants to minimize things that you have to memorize in this class, but I will tell you that the 8 pKa's I want you to memorize will serve you extremely well through the rest of the year, so it's a really good thing to do. So if you do that, alcohols are about 15. These are less than 0. Protonated amines are 10. Carboxylic acids are 5. Methane is 50. This you probably haven't looked at. That's on the expanded pKa chart. We know from the hybridization effects that it's much more acidic than this, and that is about 25. So that's one of them. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 2 more on there. And so that means that the most acidic is B, followed by D. Let's check this out. B followed by D, followed by C, followed by A, which is 15, followed by F, which is 25, followed by E. All right, so the way that I would have this problem, the way I had this on the test was not as a multiple choice. I had a little box, and you write 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on the order. So that's the way this would be on a test. Questions? Anybody? We are going to have to be making decisions about acids and bases, and sometimes we're going to have to be making decisions on, will this acid-base reaction interfere with another reaction that I'm trying to do? And so these are really, really going to help to make those decisions. All right, let's start chapter 3. There is a fair bit of memorization in chapter 3 just to learn functional groups. All right, so what is a functional group? A functional group is an atom or a group of atoms. It doesn't have to be just one atom, it can be a group of atoms with characteristic chemical and physical properties. Functional group contains either a hetero atom or pi bonds. And functional groups, kind of like the name suggests, are parts of a molecule where reactions happen. They're the parts, that's where it's all going on, is with the functional groups. So we want to be able to recognize them, and then we're gradually going to learn the reactivity of functional groups. We're not going to learn them in this chapter. We're going to learn them a functional group pretty much at a time as we go through the year. Heteroatom is an atom other than carbon or hydrogen. Common heteroatoms are nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, phosphorus, and halogens. Pi bonds, the most common pi bonds occur between carbon, oxygen, the carbon and carbon. There's also triple bonds, carbon triple bonds, and carbon nitrogen triple bonds. All right, so how do these heteroatoms and pi bonds confer reactivity? Because again, that functional group is that's the site of reactivity in a molecule. Heteroatoms have lone pairs and create electron deficient or electron rich sites on a molecule. So, here's oxygen, for example, here has lone pairs. Lone pairs make oxygen a base and a nucleophile. Also, because oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, we polarize this bond, so we have partial positive and partial negative, which is making carbon electron deficient. So we have electron deficient carbon. Or electrophilic carbon. And we know carbon's electron deficient because it has a partial positive charge. So when we're looking for electron deficient atoms, we're looking for things with partial positive charge, full positive charge, or things that don't have an octet. All of those would be in that category of electron deficient or electrophilic. Pi bond makes the compound a base and a nucleophile. Pi bonds are easily broken in chemical reactions. So the pi bond is electron rich, as we mentioned at the very end of last chapter. Pi bond makes this compound a base and a nucleophile. It's a nucleophile because it's electron rich. So we're not used to seeing pi bonds acting as bases, but they can. They can act as bases when we react them with really, really strong acids like we saw at the end of chapter 2. Carbon and carbon-hydrogen sigma bonds in organic molecules form the carbon backbone into which functional groups are bonded. But they're generally speaking the unreactive portions of a molecule. So they're often designated at R, especially when the focus is on the functional group. So the R would be the carbon skeleton. Or unreactive portion of the molecule. And this we use R when we want to just highlight what the functional group is, what the functional group is doing, properties of the functional group, things like that. So the functional group, of course, is the reactive portion of the molecule. Now, sometimes the carbons that are right next to the functional group are going to start to become reactive because of the adjacent functional group. So this carbon here is polarized because of this electron withdrawing oxygen, so it becomes electron deficient and we can have things attack. But things that are further away, that would be the R group, the unreactive portion of the molecule. All right, so let's compare here. Here's ethane and here's ethanol. Do not need to know the names yet. We will learn those coming up. Ethanol, we don't learn until 51B, the naming for that. So don't worry about naming right now. So ethane, all carbon, hydrogen, and carbon-carbon bonds. No functional group. An alcohol, on the other hand, this is going to be our carbon skeleton. We do have a polarized carbon, but we will still write this as R. Carbon skeleton. Hydroxyls are a functional group. So we have names for these, and that's the part of this chapter that you're going to have to memorize. So oxygen makes the adjacent carbon partial positive. So partial positive charge on the carbon and partial negative charge on the oxygen, just on the basis of the electronegativity of oxygen. So oxygen makes adjacent carbon partial positive. Oxygen has lone pairs. Which make oxygen a base and a nucleophile. And we have an acidic hydrogen bonded to oxygen. Because that hydrogen is bonded to oxygen versus bonding to carbon, it's going to be much more acidic. That was part of the periodic trends we talked about in chapter 2. All right, so just to get you an idea, we're going to be looking at molecules and taking them apart, looking for the functional groups. And that's what we're going to be doing in this chapter. So an overview, most functional groups can be divided into three categories. Hydrocarbons containing pi bonds. Compounds containing CZ sigma bond, where Z equals an electronegative element. And compounds containing a carbon-oxygen group or a carbon triply bonded to a nitrogen. Okay, so those are the three categories that we're going to talk about. Hydrocarbons are compounds that only contain hydrogen and carbon. They can be aliphatic or aromatic, so those are new terms for you. Aliphatic hydrocarbons can be subdivided into three categories. Alkanes, having only carbon-carbon sigma bonds. These, of course, are unreactive and don't contain a functional group. This is ethane. Alkanes have a carbon-carbon double bond as a functional group. These are both aliphatic. Aliphatic just means not aromatic. So in order to know what that means is we're going to talk about what aromatic means on the next page. So these would be anything that's not hydrocarbons that are not aromatic are aliphatic. Then we have alkynes. Carbon-carbon triple bond. This is acetylene. All three of these are aliphatic, not to be confused with aromatic. Aromatic hydrocarbons have a ring containing alternating single and double bonds. The aromatic ring is a single functional group. So here's the simplest example is benzene. These three alkenes, these three carbon-carbon double bonds do not behave independently, so we don't call them alkenes. This whole entire thing operates as a unit, and that's benzene, and that's an aromatic hydrocarbon. We could also have things bonded to benzene. This would be the single functional group. And R, of course, is the unreactive carbon skeleton. All right, so that's category number one, hydrocarbons. The second category is compounds containing CZ single bonds. And this is table one. We're going to look at that in just a second. These compounds contain electronegative heteroatom Z, which creates a polar bond. So kind of like the alcohol we just looked at. So here's our lone pair. Lone pairs on Z are also available for reaction with protons and other electrophiles, especially when Z equals nitrogen or oxygen. So this is going to be nucleophilic here. And basic Z. Because of the polarization of this bond, we have it, the electrons streaming towards Z, this is electron deficient carbon. Or electrophilic carbon. And you can see from the electrostatic potential map the polarization of this bond. This particular one that I've drawn here is methyl chloride. So we have hydrogen here, if you can't see that very well. Depends on how well it prints. We have a hydrogen here, we have a hydrogen here. And because the chlorine is more electronegative than carbon, electrons are going to flow towards the chlorine. So the chlorine is going to be electron rich, and that is where we see the red part of this electrostatic potential map. And that polarizes carbon, making it electron deficient, so you see the blue carbon being electron deficient. All right, so that's compounds containing CZ. We also have compounds containing carbon-oxygen double bonds and carbon-nitrogen triple bonds. And that's on the next page. So we have a polar CO double bond. That has a special name, by the way. I'm circling just the carbon-oxygen double bond, not the groups attached. This is a carbonyl. So it's a carbonyl group. We know that bond is really polarized. We saw that at the end of chapter one, right? Has a pretty high dipole moment. Okay, so the bond is polarized, partial positive carbon, partial negative oxygen. So we have electron deficient carbon. Electron deficient or electrophilic carbon. We have an easily broken pi bond. And we have lone pairs on oxygen, right? So that means that oxygen can be a nucleophile and base. So nucleophilic and basic oxygen. And that's disappearing off the screen there. Let's try this. Nucleophilic and basic oxygen. So this example here is acetone. If you have trouble seeing that beneath the colors here, this is acetone. And we definitely have highly polarized carbon, highly polarized carbon-oxygen double bond, or carbonyl. So highly polarized carbon-oxygen double bond, which you can see from the electrostatic potential map. And you can see definitely that with the pull of electrons towards the oxygen, leaving this area of the molecule electron deficient. And then there's compounds containing carbon-nitrogen triple bonds. Those are also very polarized, as you can see from this drawing here. We have electron-deficient carbon. We have easily broken pi bond. We also have lone pairs here. So these are the things that are going to confer reactivity on this compound. The example I have over here to the right is acetonitrile. Don't need to know the name of that. This is what it looks like. A little hard to see under the colors there, but this is what it looks like. So this whole group here is an EWG, electron withdrawing group. We saw that on page 46. Later on, you can take a look at page 46 of the notes. Yeah, we saw that that was an electron withdrawing group. So not only is this carbon electron deficient, but we also, because this is an electron withdrawing group pulling on that carbon, that makes this carbon electron deficient also. So there's a whole lot going on here when we have this particular functional group. So I know that you want to know names of the functional groups. That's one of the things you're going to be asked to do on midterm one. So let's look at some names here. If you have a halogen attached, it's an alkyl halide or a halo group. If it's a chlorine, you can write it, say, chloro group. If it's a bromine, you can write bromo group. If it's a fluorine, you can write fluoro group. Or if it's a bromine, you can write alkyl bromide. So I will accept any names that are shown here, that name or that name. So you have a molecule that has a halogen in it. But I would prefer that if, rather than halide for generic, that you actually name the halogen that's there. Okay? Alcohol. So if you have a compound that has a hydroxyl group attached, you can name it an alcohol, or you can call that actual functional group a hydroxyl group. I would accept both of those answers. Ether, ROR. The two R's do not have to be the same. They can be the same, but they don't have to be. This is an alkoxy group. OR is an alkoxy group. Amines. The nitrogen can be bonded to two hydrogens, one hydrogen, or no hydrogens. You could call it an amine, or you can call it an amino group. Thiol, SH, or you can call it a thio group. Sulfide or thioether is a sulfur analog of an ether. You can call that an alkyl thio. All right, one more table. Yes. Yeah. Are you talking about right here?
Yeah.
You don't have to draw that carbon in. That's okay, because that. It's a juncture of two. We'll talk about, that's this chart right here. Okay, so that's this chart. So these are compounds containing carbon oxygen and polar carbon oxygen, carbon nitrogen triple bond, or nitro group. So the carbonyl is just the carbon oxygen bond, but that is not specific enough. I don't want you to label it as a carbonyl. If it's a bonded to a hydrogen in an R group, it's an aldehyde. If it's got two R groups, it is a ketone. If it's bonded to an R group in a hydroxyl, it is a carboxylic acid. So if I have a molecule that has this group, you don't want to name it an alcohol. It's not an alcohol. You don't want to name it a carbonyl. It has a carbonyl, but that's not specific enough. Is that what you were asking? This is a carboxylic acid or a carboxy group. I would accept any name that we have here. Ester has a carbonyl bonded to an OR. Amide has a carbonyl bonded to an amine. It's not an amine, though. It's an amide. Acid chloride, carbonyl bonded to a chlorine. This is an anhydride. So these are three your book does not have, but I want you to know them. We're going to be using these all year. This is a nitrile or a cyano group. And this is a nitro. We still got 2 minutes, guys. We don't want to go down this pathway or we're going to run out of time at the end, I promise. Nitrile here or cyano group, nitro compound. This is a nitro group. So if I have you name this on the test, it would be either anything that you names you see appearing here. All right? So you there's nothing to do about this. You do have to memorize this. So there's quite a few questions on sapling chapter 3 that are just about functional group. Okay? So it's kind of like learning the amino acids, only it's less. We have less to learn here. All right, so functional groups, extremely important. They determine all the following properties of a molecule: bonding, shape, type, and strength of intermolecular forces, and physical properties. And they also confer chemical reactivity, as we've stated. So we'll start intermolecular forces, and we will continue on Monday. So this material, wait, we've still got another minute, guys. Add it up. I'm telling you. I promise you. You don't want me lecturing up until the 11th hour on the last week. All right. So intermolecular forces are interactions that exist between molecules. So a molecule's made up of covalent bonds. But what keeps those molecules together is intermolecular forces. So this is between molecules. If we have strong intermolecular forces, really strong, then it's going to be a hard, you're going to have a hard time pulling those molecules apart. If we have very weak intermolecular forces, the compound will be a gas. The molecules are already far apart, and it's not difficult to get them apart. We still have a minute left. So there's three that we're going to talk about, and you're familiar with these: van der Waals forces, dipole-dipole, and hydrogen bonding. So as I mentioned earlier, van der Waals forces, there's van der Waals and there's London dispersion. There are subtle differences between the two. We will only use the terminology van der Waals in organic chemistry. We'll stop right there and I'll continue this on Monday.